Good morning and welcome back to botany class. Let's quickly review what we learned in the previous class. In the previous class, you learned the types of style, entry of pollen tube in the embryo sac, double fertilization, triple fusion, events of fertilization, and types of endosperm, post-fertilization changes, and on. This class, let's start from development of dicot embryo. Development of dicot embryo, and we are going to learn the structure of seed, dicot and monocot seed. The dicot embryo, which develops in the stage of Onagrod and Cruciferous type. Onagrod, it belongs to the family Onagraceae, and Crucifer, which belongs to Brassicaceae. Example, cabbage and cauliflower. The zygote. Zygote is the result of fusion product. The male and female gametes fuse together and forms zygote. This zygote is the result of fertilization. Zygote undergo division. There is a transverse division takes place in the zygote, and it produces two cells, the upper or terminal cell and the basal or, this is the upper cell and this is the basal cell or the lower cell, terminal cell. This is basal cell. Zygote transversely divides into two and forms the upper or terminal cell or the lower cell or the basal cell. Second division takes place vertically in the terminal cell and transverse division in the basal cell, and it forms four-celled stage. It forms a four-celled stage. Here there is a vertical division, here transverse division. So it becomes four cells. Here two. Four-celled stage. So this two cells becomes four. The vertical division takes place in the terminal cell and a transverse division takes place in the basal cell. Now it forms, this four-celled stage is called as proembryo. Next, transverse division takes place right angle to this vertical division of terminal cell, and this undergo number of transverse division. When it undergo vertical division, it produces 8 cells, and first it forms a 4-celled stage, that's called quadrant. And the quadrant which forms 4 cells in this area, and it transversely divides and forms 8 cells to form octant. Now these cells undergo further divisions, the basal cells. Transversely it divides and it produces 6 to 10 cell suspensor. So now this proembryo forms a globular stage. It turns into a globular stage which contains 6 to 10 cells number of divisions, and it produces 6 to 10 cells are formed. 1 6, 7 cells. This region is called as suspensor. This suspensor, now this stage is globular stage. In globular stage, this suspensor helps to push the embryo in deeply into the endosperm. And the uppermost cell of this suspensor is elongated or enlarged, and it becomes haustorium. And the lowermost cell, this cell is called as hypophysis. So this is suspensor, this is embryonal mass. Further division takes place here. There are a transverse division and two vertical division takes place in the hypophysis, and it becomes heart shaped embryo. Now the shape of the embryo becomes heart shaped. And further division, it becomes a horseshoe shaped, a curved horseshoe shaped embryo is developed. So it undergoes number of divisions and becomes the globular stage into heart shape, and the heart shape become horseshoe shaped, and the mature embryo, which contains radicle, plumule and cotyledon. Radicle, plumule and cotyledon are seen in the mature embryo. So in the seed also contains this radicle, plumule and cotyledon. The next topic is seed. Define seed. Seed is the fertilized ovule. The fertilized ovule is called as seed. There are two different types of seed: endospermous and non-endospermous. Endospermous seed, non-endospermous seed. The endospermous seeds are otherwise called albuminous seed. Non-endospermous seeds are called as ex-albuminous seed. What's the difference between these two, the endospermous and non-endospermous? The endospermous seeds, the endosperm, what's the function of endosperm? The endosperm nourishes the developing embryo. Here the embryo is developed. This embryo takes its food from the endosperm. Sometimes the embryo consumes the endosperm completely. If it consumes the endosperm completely, there is no endosperm in the seed. So that seeds are called as non-endospermous seed. In some other cases, it does not consume completely, it leaves some. So that is albuminous seed or endospermous seed. So two types of seed, endospermous and non-endospermous. Now let's see the structure of dicot seed and monocot seed. The structure of dicot seed. Next question. So this is the first question. Today you are going to learn development of dicot embryo, 5-mark question. Second question, 3-mark question, definition. Seed definition, 2-mark question, types of seed, endospermous and non-endospermous. Now, structure of dicot seed and monocot seed. Structure of dicot seed. The example of dicot seed is Sizer. Sizer is the example of dicot seed. When you see the structure of dicot seed, the seed attached with the fruit wall by a stalk called funiculus. So first part, this is the 5-mark question. You learn very clearly. All the terms are very important for 2-mark. funiculus. The first part, the funiculus is the stalk, which is attached by the stalk in the fruit wall. That is funiculus. When this funiculus disappears, it leaves a scar called hilum. So second part is hilum. Hilum is the scar. When the funiculus disappears, it leaves a scar in the fruit wall. That is hilum. Just behind the hilum, there is a pore called micropyle. Micropyle is the pore in the sisal seed. You may see this, there is a pore. This pore facilitates the exchange of oxygen or gaseous exchange and uptake of water at the time of seed germination. So micropyle is the pore, and outer to this there is a seed coat. The seed coat is developed from the integuments. The seed coats developed from the integuments. So these integuments, the outer seed coat and inner seed coat, there are two types of integuments, outer integument and inner integument. The outer integument is called as, it converted into outer seed coat called testa, and the inner integument which converted to tegmen. The name of the seed coat is testa and tegmen. Outer seed coat is called as testa, inner seed coat is called as tegmen. In some seeds, this testa and tegmen fuse together and forms as a single layer. Mostly this outer testa, the outer seed coat is hard and thick. The inner seed coat is very thin. And when the seed develops, there is two, this is a dicot seed. The characteristic feature of dicot seed is two presence of two cotyledon. Two cotyledon arises. There is a two cotyledon. This is the embryonal axis. From the embryonal axis, the both the sides, there are two cotyledons. These two cotyledons, you store the food materials, reserve food. It stores the food materials. And this part, this is the embryonal axis. The embryonal axis just behind this part, it develops the radical, and the region above this, it produces plumule. And this embryonal axis above the cotyledon is called epicotyle, and below this cotyledon or between this cotyledon, this is hypocotyle. Hypocotyle and epicotyle. So this is embryonal axis. It develops the shoot region, which develops into the shoot system called plumule, and this part is called as radicle, which develops the root system. So this is the structure of dicot seed. Then when you see the structure of monocot seed, next question is structure of monocot seed. In the monocot seed, example Oryza, Oryza sativa or paddy. So this Oryza, the seed is single seeded. So the single seed, which is named as caryopsis. Caryopsis. In this, the seed develops, the grain which develops, which is enclosed by a husk. The brownish hard husk which covers, here is the hard husk which contains the glumes. This is husk, the grain is enclosed with husk, and this is the glumes and husk is present. And the membrane, the seed membrane, which is adhered to the grain, closely adhere or closely stick into the grain, in the seed. karyopsis seed. When you see the structure of monocot seed, in the LS of the seed, it divides into two different parts. Two parts, the upper part, which is larger than the lower part, forms the endosperm. Endosperm is the large portion, and there is a, this forms the endosperm, and a shield shaped cotyledon. This part is the cotyledon, this is the endosperm. So this divides into the portion, the entire seed is divided into two part. Upper part is large, and this cotyledon, this shield shaped cotyledon, is small in size. It stores the food materials, stores the food, and it is divided by a layer called this layer. This layer is epithelium. This layer divides these two part, and the shield shaped cotyledon is named as scutellum. Scutellum. The function of this scutellum is, this is embryo, embryo part which develops here, it takes the food from the endosperm through this epithelium. So scutellum helps the grain, or helps this seed, to absorb the food material through this epithelium. And the short axis, which is present, and it forms the plumule and the radical. The radical, which is covered by the root cap, and the plumule, which is also covered by a coleorrhiza, this is coleorrhiza, here coleoptile. The plumule, which is enclosed or covered with coleoptile, and the root part, the root cap along with the radical part, which is covered or enclosed by means of coleorrhiza. So coleoptile and coleorrhiza is present in this. So this part is scutellum, here it develops. So karyopsis. In karyopsis, you will write the structure of this, draw this diagram and write the structure of this. So two types of seed, dicot seed as well as monocot seed. So first question, you will learn development of dicot embryo. Second question, structure of dicot seed. And third question, structure of monocot seed. Now another process is called as apomixis. What is meant by apomixis? Apomixis is the process. There is another process called amphimixis. That is the normal fertilization process, takes place in flowering plants. Amphimixis. Apomixis is the process, or it is, it does not involve two main processes, that is meiosis and syngamy. What is meiosis? Meiosis is a process by which the sporophytic cells divides and it reduced its number and forms the haploid gametes, formation of male gametes and female gametes. This process is absent in apomixis. So apomixis is the process which does not involve meiosis and syngamy. What is syngamy? Union of male and female gametes. This main process also absent. So the word apomixis, or the term apomixis, was first introduced by Winkler in the year 1908, and Professor Maheshwari in the year 1950, he classified this apomixis into two different types: recurrent apomixis, non-recurrent apomixis. So what is meant by recurrent, and what's the difference between recurrent and non-recurrent? In recurrent, these two processes are completely absent. It does not involve meiosis, and this syngamy is absent. But non-recurrent, in non-recurrent apomixis, the haploid embryo sac is from the haploid embryo sac, embryo is developed without fertilization. Syngamy is absent, but meiosis is taking place. The haploid embryo sac, when you see the structure of embryo sac, here is the embryo sac. This embryo sac consists of synergids, antipodals, and secondary nucleus. These are the synergids. Synergid. These are antipodals, and this is the secondary nucleus. So normal process, normal fertilization, the male gamete fuses with the egg and form the embryo. So this is the normal process. But this syngamy, fusion of egg, the male gamete fuses with the egg, is absent. So here in non-recurrent type, haploid, this embryo sac is formed. This embryo sac is formed, and outer side you find there is an integuments. So this part, this embryo sac develops, haploid embryo sac develops by meiosis, reduction division takes place, but syngamy is absent. That is called non-recurrent type of apomixis. So recurrent type of apomixis, which includes two main processes. So recurrent type is again classified into vegetative and agamospermy. A means absence. What is absent? Here it is completely absent. Meiosis and syngamy is completely absent. Agamospermy. So vegetative, it undergoes recurrent apomixis, vegetative and agamospermy. In vegetative propagation, you know that in the beginning of this chapter, first unit, you learned that vegetative reproduction. In vegetative reproduction, the plants propagate by means of any part of the plant other than the seed. So it may be the bulbils or bulbs or the runner or sucker. You learned so many examples. Runner, example, mentha, sucker, chrysanthemum, bulbil, fritillaria, bulb, onion or allium, sepa. So this part, any other part, vegetative parts other than the seed, it develops into a new plant. That type is vegetative. It comes under recurrent type. Then another type is agamospermy. In agamospermy, it is again classified into adventitious embryony. There are three different types, diplospory and apospory. Adventitious embryony, diplospory and apospory. What's the difference among this? Adventitious embryony, the first type of this agamospermy apomixis is adventitious embryony, which is otherwise called sporophytic budding. It's named as sporophytic budding. What does it mean? How it develops? The embryo develops. This embryo here, in the normal fertilization process, after this fertilization process, embryo and seed develop, and the ovary becomes the fruit and ovule becomes the seed. But here the normal process is completely absent, but the embryo develops. How the embryo develops? From the diploid sporophytic cell. So diploid sporophytic, this is the sporophytic cell here in the embryo sac. The either the nucellus or this integument. This is the integument or from the nucellus. So embryo develops other than this egg. So fusion does not take place. So it develops either from the integument or from the nucellus. It forms the embryo, that is adventive embryony. The process is called as adventive embryony. The example is citrus. In citrus plants, we found this adventive embryony. Second type is diplospory. What's meant by diplospory? It's otherwise called generative apospory. Generative apospory. So, in generative apospory, here the megaspore mother cell which undergo there is no meiotic division. The megaspore mother cell does not undergo division, meiotic division. So, it produces diploid embryo sac. From megaspore mother cell, diploid embryo sac is formed. This embryo sac is formed without meiotic division and it produces the embryo. So, how it is possible? This nucellus, either the nucellus or integument. From here, it produces the embryo, that is diplospory. Diploid embryo sac. Diploid embryo developed without meiotic division. Then, example, eupatorium. Eupatorium is one of the example of this. Then, apospory. In apospory, megaspore mother cell undergo meiotic division. Meiotic division takes place and it produces four megaspores. So, when the megaspore mother cell divides, it produces four megaspore. Formation of megaspore takes place, but this megaspores disintegrate and it activates the new cellular tissue. Now, this new cellular tissue become activated and it produces the embryo. So, embryo, diploid embryo, which it develops from this new cellular tissue. So, this process is called as apospory. Then, another process is named as polyembryony. Polyembryony. You know the meaning poly. Poly means it is many. So, instead of one embryo, more than one embryo. Occurrence of more than one embryo is called as polyembryony. So, first it is noticed in oranges. It was first noted by Anton von Leeuwenhoek in the year 1719. So, this polyembryony also four different types. Cleavage polyembryony and formation of embryo from the embryo sac other than the egg. So, here also other than the egg, formation of embryo. Then, more than one embryo sac in the same ovule. Normally in the ovule, one embryo sac is present. But due to polyembryony, more than one embryo sac is present in the ovule. And last type is activation of new cellular and integument. This new cellular and integuments are activated and it produced polyembryony. Example, citrus. So, what's the use of this polyembryony? What's the use of polyembryony? It is used, mainly used in the orchards. Orchards, those who maintain the trees and plants or trees or shrubs for maintaining food. So, polyembryony is useful for practically, it is applicable and it used for producing virus-free plants. That's the practical applications of polyembryony. Now, one more topic you are going to study, parthenocarpy. You know that parthenocarpy is the seedless fruits, the process of developing seedless fruit. Normal process, what happens? After fertilization, post-fertilization changes taking place. In post-fertilization changes, the ovary becomes the fruit and the ovule becomes the seed. That's the normal process. But here, the fruit-like structures are developed without fertilization process. Without fertilization, fruit-like structures are formed. So, without fertilization, there is no formation of seed. So, these fruits are called as seedless fruits. So, it is called parthenocarpic fruits. There are number of examples, you know, grapes, papaya, banana, these are seedless. So, these seedless fruits are developed. There are three different types or NITS classified in the year 1963. There are three different types of parthenocarpic fruits developed. How it develops? Now, number one, Due to genetic or mutation, due to mutation or genetic variation, the parthenocarpic fruits are developed. What's mutation? Mutation is the sudden change in the chromosomal number, either in the chromosome number or in the structure of the chromosome. So due to this, parthenocarpic fruits are formed. Or second type, it forms due to environmental factors. Environment, the climatic factors, the fog or high temperature or low temperature, due to this, the environmental changes which develops the parthenocarpic fruits. The third type is chemically induced. So chemically in horticulture, the plants, the parthenocarpic fruits are produced by applying some chemicals or growth hormones in the form of auxins or gibberellins. So in this form, in this method, they are induce the developing seedless fruits. Is there any significance of parthenocarpic fruit? Yes, parthenocarpic fruits are significant, so that it is induced by horticulturist. Why it is significant? In horticulture, for producing the garden plants, it is very much useful horticulturist, and it improves the commercial value. And when you prepare the jams and jellies or this type of drinks, this for the preparation of this, the seedless fruits are very much useful, and it is it induces the high content of edible part. The edible part, if the fruit, the seed is present, the seed covers some area of the edible part. If the seed is absent, the seed part also covered with the edible part of the fruit. So these are the significance of parthenocarpic fruits. So let's review what you learned in the first unit. So the up to this, the first unit is going to complete it. So let's review what you learned in the first unit. From the beginning, there is asexual and sexual method of reproduction. First, asexual, there are vegetative method, their natural method, artificial method, and then sexual method of reproduction, including the part of flower, that is antrium, gynoecium, then process of fertilization, before that pollination, agents of pollination, types of pollination, process or events of fertilization, then types of style, entry of pollen tube and fertilization process in gamete, double fertilization, triple fertilization, post fertilization changes, types of endosperm, all this, and finally development of dicot embryo, structure of dicot seed, seed formation, monocot seed, and polyembryony, apomixis, and parthenocarpy. So learn all this question and you complete all the diagrams. Maintain the class note. Class note, you complete all the diagrams. Next class, we are going to begin the second unit. Before the next class, you complete, try to complete all these diagrams in the class note, and you learn few questions, and the questions you will get it through WhatsApp. Learn the question and make an assignment note. Write it in front of your parents. May God bless you with all success.